Okay. Wow.
Have you had enough fun yet?
No. I worked till like 1 o'clock last night, and then I flew here this morning.
Oh, so you're still in real life mode. It's not all just promotions and parties for you for the month.
I was dog sled mushing till 1 o'clock.
Wow.
And then 3 hours of sleep, and then get on plane.
So where do you do that?
Canadian Rockies.
The Canadian Rockies. Wow. What is it like to go from doing something like Aquaman to doing something like an Eternity's Gate? Is that head shredding, or is it?
No, I'm pretty good at waking up every morning and saying, okay, what do we got? Mm-hmm. They're different jobs, different kinds of movies, different kinds of people even. Clearly, I like to mix it up. That way you don't get stuck. You don't get too in love with one way of thinking or one way of living or one God, you know. So it's really that simple. And also that's just kind of naturally what's happened, you know. Traditionally, people's perception is, you know, one for them, one for me, if you're in that position to do that. But it's never really even been that. Mm. It's just kind of a practical thing that every time something gets offered to me or I go after something, it's always a combination of things that attracts me to it. Mm. And the only thing that's consistent is the director is very important. Location is a consideration, the kind of role it is, you know, but it's always mixed. So these things happen kind of naturally. But I suppose the interesting thing is, you know, the people that know me from the, you know, European co-productions or the independent films or the art films, those people don't necessarily know about the Hollywood films.
They don't even know they exist.
Yeah, they don't know each other.
Yeah, that's interesting.
But I'm used to that a little bit because I spent so many years with having a theater company that in its own circle was quite well regarded, mm-hmm. but was virtually unknown out of those circles, and then doing movies, for example, in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. and those people having no consciousness that I was a theater actor at all.
They shopped on Wooster once.
Huh?
They shopped on Wooster once.
Yeah.
With their kids. That's all I know about it. Yeah. I actually just had about 20 minutes of a half an hour interview talking to an actor about Wooster in Japan. They're doing a tour in Japan now.
And Wooster Group, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
So she was she flew back from Japan to do press for a movie. Uh-huh. And we got into this whole thing about Wooster, and we were like, why aren't you talking about the movie? It was like, it's more interesting.
Okay, yeah, yeah, no.
It inspired her. She had done a lot of TV and a lot of movies, and very into theater now.
The grass is greener.
Yeah, that's true. So is it a different acting in something like Aquaman?
Yeah, I think your job is different. The process is different, and what you're trying to achieve is different. I mean,
is there an easier, or is that non-existent?
No, not really. Not really. I mean, you know, I think there are movies where, you know, it's very clear what you have to accomplish, and other movies where, you know, your part of the movie is finding out what you're trying to accomplish. Uh-huh. And I think I like the adventures and the, you know, the safaris better than the pure execution. I like the execution, but, you know, why can't you have both?
Yeah. Well,
you know, basically, I don't want to do what I already know. I want to be surprised and I want to be transformed because I think ultimately the best performances happen when you have some sort of shift. And the audience can watch that happen, you know? I'm less interested in, just me personally, I'm less drawn to performances where, you know, people load all their good stuff on you.
Mm-hmm. So for At Eternity's Gate, did Julian just call you up and say, let's go play, or?
Not at all. I've known Julian for like 30 years. I've been in his studio with him working. I've taken part in little ways in his movies, mm-hmm. you know, as a friend, and like, because I like being around him, and he's you know, I like how he makes films, I like his films. So I know him well, and I know him socially, I know him very well. My memory is he said, you know, I'm thinking about doing this movie, but he hadn't decided to do it, and mm-hmm. he was already talking to Jean-Claude Carrière, and they were working on a script. And all he asked me to read the Naifa White Smith book, A Life, which was mm-hmm. a big biography of Van Gogh that incorporates a lot of his letters, but there's also a lot of, you know, kind of psychological interpretation. Mm-hmm. So he said, read that and take some notes and write down anything that interests you and any quotes from his letter. Just, you know, cover it for me, basically. And he still wasn't talking to me about doing Van Gogh. Hmm. But I thought, oh, that's interesting, because I had read the letters before and I found them interesting. So I did that, and I found it really rewarding, because the letters are quite fantastic. Hmm. And he had an interesting life. There's a lot of interpretation of events in that book, some which I like, some which I'm not crazy about. So I sent off the notes, and then they kept on writing, still didn't decide the movie. He still didn't ask me to do it. And then one day he called me up and said, come by the house. And I live quite close to him in New York. And I went over to his place, and he put this kind of very bad red beard on me. And Louise Kugelberg, who was very important in the as a collaborator in the movie, she, you know, put some fabrics on me, and they put me in a part of the house and got the right colors behind me. And it was like a photo session. And we shot some pictures of me. Hmm. And shortly after that, then he asked me to do it. So obviously, he had a very particular process. And now as we do press for this movie, he says, I was always the only one to do it. But we are friends, but I'm not sure. He, you know, like everything, you know, he's got a very strong vision of how things go. But he's also very good about dealing with what is. So I think the process of making this movie, you know, it was very organic. It's not like he had an idea, he executed it, and it was done, you know. He was doing many other things while he was doing it.
So when you start, so once he said, are you interested, do you start having a lot of conversations about it?
No,
or?
No, we don't talk a lot. What we do is he says, I got to get your painting.
Huh.
And that's the key to it all. So we start painting. And then the next thing is get me to Arles, you know, get me to Paris.
So for you, the key is the painting to start.
Absolutely.
So once you find that, you're finding your character, you're finding...
More or less. Because that defines, you know, Van Gogh said, I am my paintings. So to get close to him, you know, I'm not an art critic, I don't have a special sensitivity to his work, but I knew that, well, first of all, it was practical. He paints a lot in the movie.
Right.
And the movie is really about ways of seeing and about ways of, you know, in your art accounting for what you're experiencing. Mm-hmm. And it's a very subjective, you know, shooting style. So I knew I had to paint practically speaking, because who else is going to be painting in the movie, and we're not covering it.
Right.
We're shooting in a lot of long shots, and I mean long takes and loose camera, not traditional coverage.
Right.
So I'm going to be painting sometimes in real time, so I better know. I better be holding. It would drive Julian crazy if I held the brushes in the wrong way.
Right.
Or if I had my stuff, my paints disorganized, right. Or I wasn't touching the canvas right. So he became a great teacher, not only to teach me technically how to make marks, but also to paint the light and ultimately to see in a different way, which became the key, because Van Gogh was, you know, what makes him so special is his stuff still is vital. You know, he was able to touch on something eternal in that style of painting he was doing. And it wasn't certainly because he could draw well or he was doing beautiful likenesses, mm-hmm. he was able to capture something, you know, that expressed, brought you into the moment of the paintings. Mm. And it's a very mysterious thing. So if you start painting and you see the effect of making marks and you see the effect of painting light, and you start listening to what he's saying in his paintings, and then you're looking at his paintings, and then you're in the landscapes where he was painting, it becomes a pretty good mix to make you start to imagine what he was going through. Mm. And then, of course, that's my job, you know, to find some sort of personal relationship or approach or contact with, you know, a way to inhabit that character.
Well, one of the things about the movie I think that's fascinating is that it's not as detail-oriented as a traditional biopic. It's not...
It doesn't account for him.
Right.
It doesn't tell you who he was. It imagines what he was thinking and what his daily experience was. Because there's a lot of very, you know, there's a lot of just walking around and a lot of painting mm-hmm. and a lot of just talking to people.
Well, it's funny because I put on your first movie today, which has been running on Amazon Prime, I think, and The Loveless, that Catherine Bigelow co-directed with, I'm forgetting his name,
Monty Montgomery.
Okay, there you go. And it also, one of the things that was interesting in that movie was that the bikers in that movie were kind of hanging around and
doing
bored out of their minds.
Yeah.
And just fixing things.
Yeah, but for me, you know, performing is all about task, and it's all about doing actions. And the quality of being there and the quality of engagement that you have. And then if you have that super awake quality of mm-hmm. engagement, then stuff happens and you're sensitive to it. And then you're able to put your finger on something that really is, you know, that is realer than real.
So how, I mean, was the script, did it feel like, did it read like a traditional script?
No.
Not at all?
No. Because not everything's indicated.
Right.
Julian had a very clear idea of what he wanted to do, but it wasn't always indicated in the script. And he can be impulsive sometimes, very clear, but sometimes impulsive. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we'd finish early, and he'd be like, get your stuff, we're going to go out in this field. That would be what we'd do. And we'd go there, and then once we'd get there, he'd check out the light, and he'd say, start to paint, or, you know, or we'd just start to film. Some of it, there were two ways of working. I mean, one was very formal. And when you think about the film, it's a series of landscapes and a series of close-ups, really. Mm-hmm. Portraits and landscapes. That was his work, which I don't know how conscious that was. I imagine it was probably pretty conscious, but I wasn't aware of that. Mm. Those were kind of the two modes. And in the landscapes, some of the walking around in nature, that was looser, but it was always connected to some sort of action, like finding the correct reed, you know, to make the columnists with,
right.
You know? That was a concrete action, and I was really doing something there. I was really looking for a reed.
Because the cinematography is stunning at times, yeah. Where it's so captures Van Gogh, even though it's not a specific reference to anything or whatever. Just even the color of your beard, there's a shot of you lying down, I guess.
Right.
And it's just a shot across your face.
Where the sun goes into my mouth.
Yes. But it's the yellowness of it.
Yeah.
Is and the color of the beard and all those things reference the paintings.
Julian's a painter.
Yeah.
So is Benoit, for that matter.
Yeah.
So you're dealing with two visual artists making a film about a painter.
Because I mean, there were times where I thought it could be almost a silent movie. I mean, there's information that is put across, and there are a couple chatty moments. but mostly, I felt so much from you just watching you you work, and you know, it was fascinating that way.
I must say though, I also like those conversations, and they're fun because they're a mix of kind of philosophy and sincere statement.
Yeah.
One of the things that impressed me about Van Gogh was he's so sincere. It's not what we think. You know, he's usually mm-hmm. depicted as this crazy, out of his mind guy. He was so sincere. He wanted so badly to, you know, serve, connect with his spiritual longing, and be useful. It seemed. It seemed just in my imagination, by what you read in his letters to his brother, he had this incredible ecstasy that he'd experience when he'd go out in nature and he'd paint and he'd lose himself. And then he didn't know what to do with that. I mean, he applied himself and made beautiful paintings, but how, what that meant, you know, to other people and to his life, you know, there was a disconnect.
Well, people didn't, I guess, they weren't ready for it.
Not just that, he was socially awkward, you know. It's like he felt too intensely. He was looking beyond kind of social convention and you know, dualistic thinking. You know, he was like going deep. He was going into the unseen very much. And he talks about that.
Yeah.
In the scene with the priest, there's some talking about that. And he's often referencing Jesus, you know. He had a heavy identification with Jesus. Thought the Bible was the best book ever written.
So did you, having been Jesus, did you make that connection?
Jesus. I got to correct you. I wasn't Jesus. I was a Jesus. And that's a big distinction.
Yes, it is.
Just like I was a Van Gogh.
But, I mean, did your history of delving into that character affect how you went after this character?
Only that they were both experiences where I'm at the center of something, and they're both characters that are, in certain aspect, martyred, and they struggle with a kind of responsibility. So there were similarities. And also they were similar because they were both, these are two of my most favorite, you know, experiences in cinema.
In doing the work.
Yeah, and also the films, I like them both.
So do you watch every film?
When they're done, yes. I can't resist. I mean, I'm curious to see how they turned out, to see what the experience of making them was like compared to the finished product. It's, you know, and also if I'm doing press on it, I like to know what I'm talking about.
And what's your happiness percentage?
My happiness? You know what? Listen, I'm very conscientious, I'm very disciplined, but I'm also pretty good at letting stuff go. I mean, I like the failures. Because, I mean, I accept the failures, so I don't have a big thing about, oh, no, not that movie. I can't do that.
Right.
Because I know some movies that are terrible for some people are great for other people.
Every movie, really.
Huh?
Every movie is like, I mean, it's a film critic, you find out very quickly that
it's really
whatever
true.
Your opinion is, there's somebody else with a very strong
opposite. You know, one of my favorite things when I've been on juries, in international juries, it is so fascinating to see how hard cultural conditioning is, because a Chinese intellectual can look at a stupid Australian comedy and see beautiful telling things in it, where I see it and it's like, this is garbage, you know?
Right.
Or I can see some Russian film that I find really poetic and some Russian guy can say, this is bullshit, you know? And it's just interesting. So I'm kind of, I don't feel like, you know, I'll take it. If I did it, I'll own it. And if it's bad, it's bad for you. Was it bad for me? I tried not to make it bad. Nobody tries to make a bad movie. I mean, really, it's the luxury of making lots of movies. I'm conscientious, you know. I really work hard. And when I'm making the movie, I'm making the movie. I can't think ahead or back. That is one talent I can admit to and I'm proud of. Mm. I'm pretty present-minded when I'm working. But yeah, I'm sure I make bad movies sometimes.
Did that come to you as a young man?
No, because I didn't have, you know, the experiences to buffer me.
So it just took some time and experience to figure out that it wasn't about you so much.
Yeah, you said it very well. Yeah, and I wish you would have been with me in the last interview I did, because that's really it. What has changed for me is it's not about me. And I'm happy it's not about me, you know? Mm. Because I'm not here. And I'm in a profession where that supports that.
Yeah. So does the exterior perception of you, or whether love or, I don't really know anybody who doesn't like your work, but I mean, does that affect you much outside of just being gracious and...
You mean how stuff gets received?
Yes, and even more by the public than by critics even. I'm just, you're kind of you are an icon at this point.
That's nice. I don't know. No, it's important. I mean, I'm like anyone. I'm like, the butcher down the street. I want people to like my cuts of meat, you know. I want people to like what I do, and I want opportunities to do the things that I love to do to continue. But at the same time, I'm very conscious that if I get too obsessed with that, I'll get off track. I mean, I probably talk about it too much, but as I get older, you know, and I see colleagues, you know, the level of, you know, some people get better, some people get worse. And why do they get worse? Because of a certain kind of corruption and a certain kind of distraction, you know? Mm-hmm. They start to drink the Kool-Aid too much, you know? They start to believe in stuff that people tell them rather than what their experience is. Mm. You can say that about any life, but since being a performer, there's a public self and a private self. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the public self. So, listen, the truth is I can be cocky and I can talk kind of high-minded like this because I'm feeling pretty good at the moment, mm-hmm. because lately I've found really different and interesting projects. I've found interesting people to work with. I feel stronger and more flexible as an actor. Mm-hmm. So I'm feeling a little cocky, but I know right around the corner is always, you know, those times of where you're out of sync or you're out of failure or the project that you, you know, feel like you need doesn't come. I mean, you know, it's really about trying to develop a kind of steadiness, a kind of, you know, peace with yourself that makes you indestructible as far as, you know, you don't get deluded by your successes and you don't get destroyed by your failures. Because, you know, you get practiced at the ups and downs. And I'm not perfectly practiced, but it's a relative practice. Yeah.
We had Brian Tyree Henry in here the other day, who is in Beale Street, and he's in the Spider-Man animated movie that's coming out, and he's also in Widows, and he's having this, and he's in Atlanta, which is a series very successful right now, very popular, doing a lot of stuff.
Right.
And the degree of humility and kind of just happiness to be working with such good people was just such a lovely thing to see in a young guy who's kind of in the skyrocketing moment.
He's a good actor.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I don't know his work.
You think he's full of shit?
To have that kind of humility at a young age, it's hard for me to believe.
It is. But he's like, well, I mean, he comes from a humble background and ended up, of course, at Yale. But he, like, he talked about the Yale experience and how that was, and as a black man, it's different.
Right.
And he was conscious of all that. Yep. And but it was fascinating because it was, I find a lot of, there seems to be as the democratization of the indie movement happened because of the equipment and everything else, there seems to be a different energy coming from that group than they don't seem to have to fight quite as, so the highs are not as high and the lows are not as low.
But
they're still fighting together.
But there's you know, making movies is one thing, but getting them out there is another thing. That's what's changed so radically.
Mm. So this is a happy, your stuff is getting seen.
My stuff is getting
right
seen, and I'm working in different modes. You know, and also as you get older, you just worry that you know, it's a youth culture, they put you out to pasture, you know?
Yeah.
And I can still do action stuff. I always love doing physical stuff. you know, I'm not talking about, we're not talking literally, but I think I'm a physical actor. That's, I believe in the wisdom of the body. I'm, as I said before, I think of performing as tasks, as movement, you know. That's what I like to do. And sometimes you get to a certain age and you start playing fathers and uncles and, you know.
Well, some review of this movie
judges
pointed out, I think it was Manola Dargis, pointed out that you were 20 years older than Van Gogh was when he died.
Not only Manola, but many people are aware of that. But that's, I think that's not Manola, but it comes kind of from, I don't know the context of her saying that.
Right.
And
she was saying didn't matter, mostly, but...
It didn't matter. But some people said it as this kind of scandalous thing, like, you know, whatever that age equivalent is of whitewashing, you know?
That's interesting.
I thought, that is such bullshit, because Van Gogh, he was 37 years old, at a time that the average, you know, life expectancy was 41. So he was toward the end of his career, his life. He also was obsessed with death. He was also an absinthe drinker. So, you know, really, I mean, that 40 then was 70 now. So you couldn't have a young man play that. You know, you couldn't have a 37-year-old man play in that movie. You could, but it would be a different movie. Yeah. And we made our movie, and you didn't pay for it, so watch it, you know, watch it and like it or not, you know. But don't get into this stupid conversation about he's 20 years older. I don't think it's worth mentioning.
No. The funny thing is, it did make me think of Schrader's movie, A First Reformed, and I thought about it for a second, and I thought, really, the difference between you and Ethan for that role is that your face is, Ethan's beautiful, but your face is more interesting. And in some ways, him being more traditional looking, more kind of square jawed, you know, whatever, fits that role. Because it has a plainer, the guy has to be kind of average, not...
Right, right.
Which, so that struck me. Because I thought otherwise Schrader would probably maybe have called you. Or
I've worked a lot with Paul.
So much Schrader under the bridge.
Yep, yep. And I'll work with him again, probably.
Well, it's nice to see him having a big success at this point also, you know?
It is, yep.
It's a hard road to when you get over 60 and you're a director particularly, they really stop calling. For some reason, they think that people over 60 don't have an opinion, you know, they're not hip anymore, and they just stop making movies with them.
I don't know about that, but...
It's hard. It's bad. Yeah. Though you are, I don't know how old is Julian? He's probably getting up
Julian's, he's older than me.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think he's maybe 67.
He stays young.
Huh?
He stays young.
He does.
So what do you take away from... So you've had this experience with this movie, which was joyous. You like the movie also.
I do.
Great.
Yeah.
Is there something that you consciously or subconsciously hold with you from that experience? Or are you now three movies away and...
No. I think about it a lot. Of course, I'm doing press, so I got to think about it a lot. certain things about the painting will stay with me. And about also just Julian's way of working. I love it so much. I'm not sure I know how to describe it, but he works with a lot of love, a lot of joy. He sort of makes a family. He's got a very clear idea of what he wants to do. But when he gets there, like so many great artists, he deals with what's there. He doesn't force it.
Right.
So he comes in the room, and he has an idea of what he wants to do, but if something arises, he'll deal with it. He won't deny it. And maybe that doesn't sound so special, but it is, because often, particularly in film, because films have days to make, they have budgets, you know, they're all structured to you make the day and you got to get that and there and you got to make that and we got to have lunch. And, you know, if you can free yourself from that and still get stuff done, but be like on top of it.
Mm-hmm.
Julian's on top of it. He doesn't worry. And it's partly because of how he structured the movie, how he structured his crew, how he cast, these sorts of things. He's very free. He's a happy man when he's working, and he works very organically. And I like that, and how an actor folds into that environment. You know, we'd spend a lot of time in the mornings, sometimes just setting up the room. It was like nesting, you know? It's really about creating a personal relationship to it, not in a kind of overthought, you know, backstory, talking about it. We talked very little, but we did a lot, you know? When we go into a room, we'd make it ours. And so Julian's way of working and all the stuff about painting, painting light, marks, the idea of an accumulation of little things that create their own rhythm and create their own life. It reminds me of performing so much.
Yeah.
You know, performance is a series of actions, and gets a rhythm, then it starts to have a life, and then you start to react to that rhythm, and then you, that becomes what happens, that becomes the event. And you know, I think so much of movies, people, when they try to account for them, they talk about story, they talk about narrative, they talk about interpretation, they talk about choices. Those aren't the things that interest me. You know, what interests me is the sense of place, you know, the atmosphere, the new way of seeing, the challenge to how you think about things.
Well, I think that's the, I mean, that's when you talked before about the, you liking the failures.
Well,
I mean, that's, but I mean,
I went overboard.
Well, but you have to, I mean, I think with the way Julian works, the way some of the really good directors work, who work in this form that's not quite as, everything is not as literal and page, do every, you know, script line the same exact way. That you don't. That,
but don't get me wrong, that script, we did it verbatim.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like we're out there just,
out there improvising.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's also like you, when those things come together, I always say, like somebody will say to me, I hear something's going badly, and I'm like, let them have another 3 months in editing before you start judging.
Yeah.
Because it's not the convention, and those are often the best movies.
Yes.
And none of Julian's films, really, could you have guessed that all those pieces would come together the way they were going to come together as he shot them? I don't think.
I don't know. I don't agree with that necessarily, because they have such a sense of place. And when you're shooting them, they have a real sense of place. They're very particular. They have his stamp on it, and they have the stamp of what's going on.
Yeah.
And
but life happens in his rooms.
Yes.
He creates spaces where life is happening.
You come on me with these interviews. And I'll nudge you in there.
Well, that's true.
No, this is exactly what I'm trying to express. It's not an interpretation. It's not pointing at something. It's the thing itself. And that's what's important when you're making movies, to have that quality. Mm. That it's not pointing to stuff that's outside of the frame. You're seeing it. It's happening. It's happening to you because you're witnessing it. You're with this. And particularly with a very subjective camera like we have on this. You're doing what Van Gogh's doing. You are him. And that's a trick. It's risky. And it's hard, and some people would be repelled by the very subjective camera. But for me, I think it's quite strong, and it's an interesting approach to the material.
Well, the audience has to let themselves feel.
I think so.
And I think that's often, particularly sometimes with film critics, but you know, people get their hackles up when they're either doing a lot of the work or
because they want the job done.
Yeah.
They want, you know, the breadcrumbs to be put down.
Mm. So when you, going back to your first film, because I'm now obsessed with it, I'm going to have to watch it over and over again.
That's okay.
But were you a good actor then, in your mind?
I don't know. I was game.
Well, was there a time where you went, I now know what I'm doing, that changed for you? Or has it all been just a progression of different jobs and moments and
you know, I don't know. I can honestly say you got to remember also, I come from a theater tradition that was not a traditional theater tradition. It was a theater that was, you know, created from dancers, writers, architects, people that weren't trained in that profession.
Right.
So this idea of good actor, bad actor, I've never thought of myself as a good or bad actor. Huh. But I know when I'm making something and I'm a doer in that thing, it's like going on an expedition, or it's like fighting a war or something. You know who the good soldiers are. You know who gets the job done, you know? I don't know. I don't think the good actor, bad actor. Sometimes I don't even feel like an actor. Mm. But I know I'm game, I'm flexible, and I can do stuff. And I'm, you know, yeah, I can transform.
And when you look backwards and something tickles your fancy, when you feel like, oh yeah, that was a pleasure, is it what happened making the movie? Is it the movie itself? I mean, do you think like, to live and die in LA,
it's the pleasure of making the movie. Yeah, because that always overshadows the movie itself.
You can't really forget that
because
part.
The movie itself is a you know, a construction of, made out of the thing that, you know, I lived. Even if it's in a structured, you know, ritual, you know, film thing. Environment.
And do you have a forward-thinking mode? Are you worried about what's going to happen now past the next movie or the next adventure or the next...
No.
You're just happily going forward and doing your thing.
Yeah, and that serves me well.
And you'll be back to mushing dogs in a couple days?
Yes, Monday. I was mushing dogs hours ago. Give me a little rest.
Will you get a nap at least? Will they let you take a sleep or something? Or you have to do interviews at 3 a.m. at some club?
No, we're happy.
And when will mushing will be next year, I guess?
Mushing will be next year, yeah.
I'm giving it a title already. Mushing
it's
the movie.
It's called Togo.
Togo. And who's the director?
Named for the dog. Erickson Kaur. Do you know who that is?
Is not Erickson the one Kaur. From Fast Times. No, that's E.W. Erickson.
No.
Who is Erickson Kaur?
Erickson Kaur has directed, I don't know how many films, but he, for a long time, he was a DP, mm-hmm. and he shot a lot of, you know, big, great with action, great with nature stuff. I forget the name. He did a movie for Disney with Marky Mark, Mark Wahlberg, that I think did well. I didn't see it. Mm. He did the remake of Point Break. But we're having a good time.
Yeah. We get you in the remake of the remake of Point Break. Huh. That thing goes on forever. You have a lot of films like that to go on forever that people remember.
Like what?
Even like Streets of Fire, which...
Streets of Fire was great fun.
People have...
And I loved Walter Hill. He was so much fun to work with.
Yeah. And did he... Were you in that type from your first movie? We keep on going back.
Yeah.
To see Catherine you in that motorcycle
Bigelow,
jacket.
Catherine Bigelow, who knew... I think she was friends with Walter.
Walter. Mm.
And he saw a little clip of that. And I think he cast me because of that.
It was fortuitous.
Yeah, yeah.
To say the least.
Yeah.
No, I think your films are... I think it's actually going to be interesting as we get to this... The streaming era expands and people have easier access to some of your lesser-known films also, that they will find things that they didn't find. And you know, movies
absolutely.
Like Light Sleeper and that didn't get as much...
Not even. I think of something like Pasolini by Abel Ferrara. How they get financed, they're kind of outside the system.
Right.
So when it comes time, you know, they may do the festival circuit and they may not get bought up big. Mm-hmm. So then they're kind of in this limbo. Why that is non-streaming or some platform hasn't bought that seems incredible. It's a beautiful movie. It's a small movie, but it's also about Pasolini. And, you know, every gay kid in Iowa should be seeing this movie. And they would want to, I think, if it was available. But, you know, it's kind of outside kind of business thinking. So, you know, but now that there's these different platforms, of course, there are some people that are less strictly business-minded. And it'll kind of shadow, you know, the birth of the independent film. You know, it'll be an alternative to the, you know, the mainstream thing.
But it's going to be very interesting to watch, because I think that a lot of films, like a lot of the libraries which aren't out there yet, are going to be out there in a few years, a couple years, and people will, the weight that is put on new product,
right,
and the budgets that are being, you know, spent on new product is going to be, it's going to be very interesting tension.
Well, there's so much stuff out there that you wonder, you know, like, look what happened to TV.
Yeah.
It's a glut now. Nobody knows what to look at now.
And we're getting more and more.
And we're getting more and more.
Yeah. And that's even without the library. I mean, that's what my thing is that the studio library
I don't even
barely
watch TV.
There.
I'm too busy watching movies.
Yeah.
Really.
Well, Filmstruck, I don't know if you're a Filmstruck person, but...
Yeah, I heard.
That just went down.
Yeah, I know.
It'll be back. You know, it's in Warner's interest to make it part of this bigger package that'll come out at the end of the year, but...
Yeah.
It's that they were one of the companies. They were just beginning to really spend some money on movies like Pasolini and finding, you know...
Right.
Things that weren't their mainstream, weren't just Criterion and the Warner Library, but then they're gone. But that'll change again. It all keeps changing. Once you've done the work, you've done the work. We have you forever. You can't escape.
I see Brenna with her bag. That means something.
Brenna's back. Thank you so much for your time.
Sure.
I appreciate it.
Okay.